Our breath is vaporizing here. Oh, we're all... It's freaking out. Turn up the heat. It's freezing out here in California. No, it's a beautiful evening. and enjoying it here. I did my usual jog, and my best time was 14 minutes and 15 seconds. Tonight, it was 13 minutes and 13 seconds. I knocked off a minute just in one day. And that's what I have been saying, that as you exercise your capacity of inner clarity and being able to differentiate, process of clarification, differentiation, you're able to, it goes along for a while and you feel like you're not getting anywhere, then suddenly you are able to make a huge jump and you realize, wow, I'm way, way in better shape for far as that capacity to differentiate between truth and lies. I'm way beyond what I used to be. I'm in great shape, much better shape. And just keep going and you'll get in better and better shape. It's just like the jog. Somehow I hit a new gear. And it was just there. I could just get it, shift into actually running instead of jogging. And the gear was just there. It wasn't there before. So it's just a matter of exercising. What was that? A bug? Wow. Okay. Being able to differentiate. The capacity to differentiate. You have to work on that. And work on that. And work on that. And when a bug hits you like that, you just brush it off and keep on going. Keep on going. Because there'll be days when you don't feel good. Like yesterday, jogging, I felt terrible. And I tried to quit. And I couldn't. You know, I just said, I gotta try to grind this out and finish. Today, for some reason, I started out feeling pretty bad, but then that new gear was suddenly there. There's some spring to the step. So when your inner ability to differentiate between truth and lies, between the real and the unreal, some days you'll feel lousy and you say, I just can't, I'm just terrible, I can't hardly do it, what's the matter with me? And other days, suddenly you'll shift into a higher gear and you'll say, wow, I'm really going now, this is fantastic. That's how it goes. Two steps forward, one step back. But as you take two steps forward and one step back, you're still taking a one step forward. And you still will go into territory where you'll see clearer and clearer and clearer. So, of course, everyone is seeing from the perspective where they're at now. And how is their perspective formed? Depending on how much they are intimidated by belief. That's how perspective is formed. We see as much as we believe it's safe to see without getting belief too angry at us. So, and fearing reprisals. So, of course, your perspective is going to change as you go along. Of course it will. My perspective has changed thousands and thousands of times. Every day there's a new perspective, actually. It's better. Better and better perspective as the fear of belief and what it can do to us is diminished. Then it's just you can see so much more clearly. And your perspective will... It will change. So I don't judge perspectives. No, we should not judge other people's perspectives because they're simply doing the best they can with depending on how much they're engaged with belief. What we have to do is encourage everyone to stand up to that bully of belief, and we have to have examples of doing that, and we have to believe that it's worth the effort and it can be done. That's called motivation. So I've always been banging the drum saying we need those in the world who have stood up to the bully of belief perfectly to show us, to motivate us and show, wow, look what a great, wonder how wonderful it is to achieve that, to reach that. And recently we now have not had that, which is not to my satisfaction, which is a big, big problem. And then you have those who are in the process of, you know, encouraging others like these videos. But I haven't stood up 100% at all. No, it'd be a big difference when that happens. So you need those who can show you, attract you to the goal, seeing the goal is worth reaching because it's so wonderful. And then also you see it's doable. It is doable. It's doable. It can be done. It can be done. It's just a matter of continually pushing back against belief. Pushing back against that bully. Some people call it the ego. Of Course in Miracles calls it the ego. I call it belief. because the ego is just believed in, actually. So it really is just, ego is just belief. It's a belief system that is intimidating us, and that's its job. The job we gave it was to intimidate us, so of course it does a great job. The job we gave it was to intimidate us so that we would continue, stay loyal to this effort, because the way we looked at it was something we had to do over a long process of effort. It would be very difficult to do, so we need to just keep on working at it, keep on working, so we have belief intimidate us into believing that if we stop working, something terrible is going to happen to us, which is not true. But belief is super good at intimidating us. But as we get wise, we start saying, wait a minute, you know, this, I don't like this. I want out of this situation. I need to push back. I need to push back. And then belief will, you know, snarl at you like a ferocious, some wild, ferocious beast. Like it's going to jump you, you know, and you just have to stand your ground and say, no, I'm in charge, and keep backing it away, backing it down. So let's not judge anyone's perspective. But at the same hand saying, look, you need to continue your efforts against the bully of belief. Because the problem is, if we don't have an example or some really good examples in the world, belief can really put the pressure on us by saying, look, you know, maybe it's not possible, right? And maybe the goal may not be so attractive. We're not really sure. Is it worth it? Is it worth all this battle with belief? And that's a gigantic problem. I used the teacher Ananda Mai Ma, who was here 1896 to 1982, during 24 of my years, up till I was 24, 66, 76. 26 of my years, was here on this planet, and a lot of videos, a lot of pictures. I was able to get a sense of how great the goal is, how wonderful, how happy she was, how blissful, and so I had some attraction to the goal. I said, it's worth it. Also getting an inner glimpse, but seeing that someone can do it, so be here and experience that, I felt that's a very powerful motivation. Whereas if we don't have that powerful motivation, belief starts to eat away at us and undermine us, and saying, you really want to, let's make a deal. It's not really not that great. You know, it's not that much better than where you're at right now. There's the problem, right? If you think, well, it's not really that much better to get rid of belief, and maybe we can cut a deal, cut a compromise. Maybe we can, you know, work with this thing, sit down, have a talk, and all this kind of stuff. So it's always been my perspective that having someone in the world who is perfectly free of belief and is absolutely radiantly present beyond all belief is the cornerstone. It is the cornerstone. And in this day and age, it seems to me we're lacking that cornerstone. There are those that have some attractiveness. Yeah, that's true. But the real powerful, strong cornerstone, wow, we're missing that. And that makes it really tough, really tough. And I'm seeing how belief is able to intimidate people. They don't quite have the determination because they're not sure the goal is worth it, the work is worth it, the difficulty facing up to that monster, the bully of belief, and suffering all the stress of the struggle. They say, well, you know, why should I be doing this? Why should I be doing this? Let me just go hug some people and discuss something spiritual and just kind of feel good about being comfortable with other people and tell them that I love them, and that's good enough. It's not good enough. It is not good enough. So the drive to get there has something has to fuel that drive. Something has to fuel it. And what better than someone who is just absolutely in pure, perfect bliss and is just radiating that to you and smiling. Not fakery. It's not an emotional effort. There's some kind of just incredible radiation of certitude. Complete certitude. Perfect certitude. Just radiating there. And they're not asking anything of you at all. They don't need anything from you. But they realize, hey, I'm here to motivate you. It's motivation. What we need on the path is motivation. Without motivation, how can anyone possibly succeed? And what basis would they have to succeed? So suffering is a motivator for sure. But I'm looking at those who have been suffering. I've seen many who have been suffering who don't even try. They just say, look, I'll just take some drugs and try to knock this out and get by until I die. I used all forms of motivation, boredom, severe suffering, a perfect presence of a perfect certitude here in the world, great book, Course in Miracles. I'll combine all these motivations and then just keep, you know, determination, and then inner glimpses of reality, and then progress. The whole ball of wax needs to be brought to bear on the path. The whole ball of wax for everybody. Or else it's too difficult. I'd be dishonest if I said it was easy. You know, it's not easy. It should be easy. We keep intuitively say, well, it should be simple. It should be easy. So maybe I'll just wait until I get it. I'll just wait. Doesn't work that way. Belief bluffs us. It bluffs us, and the bluff is so convincing and so problematical to us that we hesitate and we wait. But then belief gives us a lie about why we're waiting. So we believe what we're waiting is what we're supposed to be doing, and it's not. It is not. Any day that goes by when you're not giving a full out effort is a day you've been fooled by belief. It's trickery is you just every day you'll discover different layers to it. And not that you're cataloging it, I don't catalog it at all, but you'll just notice it and you'll say, wow, no wonder why I was, you know, being kind of held back. And I'd say, I'm not ready, I don't have the right stuff yet. No wonder. Because belief was saying, sure, you can get it like that, but then how do you integrate it when belief comes back into the picture? And so then you're worried about, okay, how do I integrate this, you know, reality with belief? And then you don't have it. Then you're frantically trying to figure out how to integrate it. There is no integration. Belief does not return. Once you choose a new idea and say, that's enough belief, there's no more return of belief. Once you stand up to its demand, there is no more demands. But belief is bluffing, saying, what about when my other demands come into the picture? How are you going to deal with those? And you think, I better figure that out before I, you know, have you drop this one. It's just, you know, incredibly clever, because it's really our own creativity being turned against us, trying to fixate us on this idea of wanting to be prime creator. It's our own creativity, the creativity of spirit and mind, creativity that we were created with, turned against us. So of course it is supremely clever, and yet there's something within us that can see the cleverness. That's the amazing thing. And that's what most people don't realize and have not gone far enough on the path, because of lacking motivation to realize there's that which in us, within us, that is able to see the cleverness and look, see right through it and say, dismiss it. So it's our creativity that's coming from a different idea, you see, a blessing from the prime creator in this case, that is not judging the creativity of this idea of belief, but is seeing it simply as it is. It's the capability to simply see all as it is. So it sees the cleverness simply as it is. It's not fooled at all by it. Just sees it and says, okay, that's just what it is. No reaction, just sees it. But then in that seeing, Spirit's saying, oh, wow, I'm really not stuck here as like I believed I was stuck. It's really not a stickiness at all. There's no stickiness to that. I just believed there was. It was just a bluff. I'm not stuck. I'm being bluffed. I'm not in the pit. I'm believing that I'm going to be in the pit, as it were. And that I somehow have to figure out how to get out of it once I get into it. But I'm not there yet. I'm not there yet. But in the future, I believe I will be there. So we're really working on the future and believing that we need to figure out a way to get out of this pit. We're not even in it. We're not even in it. So the shift from focusing on the future to right now is what many teachers say is the all-important shift. That's one way to look at it. You can approach it from that angle, because we are actually not in the pit. We've not fallen into that black hole. We're not there. We're on the edge, looking into the black hole, believing there is a black hole there. Actually, there isn't even one there. We're imagining it to be there. But we are not in it. We are not in it. We're simply projecting of what it would be like when we fall into it, and imagining, dreaming of how it's going to be once we actually fall into it. That's the dream, as we say. It's not a dream like when we fall asleep at night. That's just an analogy. So waking up doesn't mean waking up at night while you're sleeping and I wake up. Oh, I woke up. Maybe I woke up from the dream. No. It's just an analogy. And belief takes it literally. But it's just an analogy. None of us are in that pit right now. It's all a projection into the future of what we believe is going to take place, will take place, but it won't. It will not. And yet we're lost in this dream of imagining what it would be like, and how do we get out of there. But you don't get out of there by making it real and then escaping the reality, because trying to do that just terrifies you, because you believe reality can be destroyed, attacked, changed. And you know you are reality, and you don't want to be annihilated. So the way out is not to say, to agree that you're in there, and find a way out once you're in there, is to say you're not in there. You've never gone, and you never will go in there. That is the way out. You haven't yet fallen into the black hole, and in fact, you never will. So all this anticipatory imagining, a hypothetical scenario, you don't need to do it. Now, of course, those who are doing this hypothetical scenario believe they're ahead of the game. And they say, well, when I fall into this black hole, I'm going to know how to get out of it. And I'm going to know how to establish a beautiful, wonderful kingdom. And I'll be perfectly happy. So I already know how to do it. I figured it out. So I got no worries. I'm not afraid. So they haven't reached that point. They always believe they're almost there. They've almost figured out how to escape it. it's an imagination. It hasn't happened, but it's the presumption it will happen. But it can never happen, because it's not real. It's not real. How can reality be within something that is not real? That's not possible. Reality cannot be changed. There is no black hole in reality. We are totally included in reality, as all aspects of reality are equally perfectly included. All reality is real. It will always be real. There's no such thing as a black hole. There is no such thing as something unreal in reality. There's nothing unreal exists. So we cannot fall into unreality. We can't fall into anything like that. It's not possible. It'll never happen. So this dream of figuring out how to escape once we do fall in, is a waste of time, and we'll never come to a conclusion of how to escape it. Because how do you escape a dream? Because in a dream, you can continue dreaming that you haven't escaped it, which is the whole purpose, actually, of this dream, is to believe we can change reality. And so we will just continue on, and in a dream, you feel powerless, helpless. You can keep thinking you almost got, almost escaped, and then the dream will change, and suddenly you find yourself falling back down to the bottom of the pit. You go, what happened? Something changed, something got me. I wasn't expecting that. So really, in a dream, you're helpless. And the purpose of the dream is in control of the symbolization of yourself in the dream. The purpose of the dream is in control of that and will have its way with that. And the purpose of the dream, you could say, you can talk about it different ways. One of them is to say that you have to learn to love the dream. Now, let's talk about love. That's important because I go on the internet and look at all these teachers and all these teachings in the past right now. Say, love, 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 love. You're here as a classroom. You're here to learn to love. Well, there's one huge problem with that. You cannot learn to love because love comes because something is lovable. What is lovable? Reality is lovable. Permanence is lovable. Impermanence, a dream, is not lovable. So it's impossible to learn to love. Totally impossible. Which that assumes that there's something that's unlovable there. If it's unlovable, you can't love it. You cannot love a dream of your own destruction, of your own imprisonment, of your own torture. You cannot. You cannot love this impermanence. This instability is not lovable. So only reality is lovable. So forget it. Don't worry about love, 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 love. Worry about realizing that this is all a hypothetical scenario and you're not in this mess in the first place. It's a projection into the future. And then you'll see what is lovable. And then you'll say, I love everything because what you're seeing is lovable. You're seeing the overlay, the perfect overlay of all impermanence. And certainly that is lovable. That's what love is. Love is that which is lovable. And all of reality is lovable. And none of the dream is lovable. It is not. And we distract ourselves immensely by trying to learn to love. And belief has us engaged. If you look at your life, you might be able to see that your belief has put you in situations and it tells you you haven't yet learned to love this situation. And so you're spending your life trying to learn to love the situation. The fact that the situation is not lovable. So it's not lovable, so there can be no love there. Cannot. And belief as it pretends to be your mentor, your guide, your God, and is saying, your only problem here in this existence, it calls it life, you know, the universe, life, your only problem is that you haven't learned to love yet. And so I'm giving you these opportunities to learn how to love, so I put you in these terrible situations, and you don't want to be there. And it keeps telling you, no, you need to stay there because you haven't learned to love it yet. And I'm saying, well, wait a minute. You know, time out. Let's take a time out here. Time out. Blow the whistle. Throw the flag. Say, I want to challenge this ruling on the field. Because I say, wait a minute. This isn't lovable at all. Delusion, insanity. Is insanity lovable? Is delusion lovable? Is a hypothetical projection of the future of your own destruction lovable? Our scenario where we're generating a way to destroy reality, is that lovable? No, it's not. Is all this impermanence and death, and is that lovable? No, it's not. So how can you learn to love it? You cannot. And yet we believe that this is the will of God for us, that somehow we're here to learn how to love all this stuff. No, we're not. We are not. And I don't care who or what teacher says that that's what we're here for, that they are mistaken in saying that. At least my perspective varies from that 180 degrees, all right? And I'm going with my perspective at this point, absolutely. It's not lovable. This dreamlike scenario of impermanence and vulnerability and terror and fear, dream of fear, is not lovable. Fear is not lovable. But there's no fear in reality. Reality is lovable. Belief is not lovable. Will never be. And so belief is trying to teach us how to learn how to love belief, and it can never happen. And we have all these people working so hard trying to be spiritual, trying to learn how to love. And I just shake my head and say, people, what are you doing? You can't learn to love this scenario. If you want love, realize this is just a projection, a hypothetical scenario projected in the future, and you're not even there. It's not even happening to you at all. And then you'll choose a new idea, another idea of not trying to be prime creator, not trying to change reality. Therefore, you don't need a projection in the future. You don't need to project a hypothetical scenario in the future. And so then you realize what you are right now, and you realize you're in reality right now. And what happens is you'll realize an overlay of all of this hypothetical scenario. So there's a sense of continuity. People ask me, what happens when I wake up? You're still here. You're still seeing everything, but you're seeing it overlaid with right now, with this unconditional, seamless, unconditional love effect, which is lovable because it's not trying to destroy itself. It's not trying to change hide its cause. It's not trying to hide its cause. It's lovable. So you love everything in the world. The gurus say, I love it. I love everything. That's because they're seeing this overlay, this perfect overlay, and it's lovable. They're seeing what is lovable. They're seeing what is lovable. But what we're seeing, what belief is showing us, is not lovable, will never be lovable. So we're wasting our time. All these earnest people trying so desperately to be spiritual and please belief because they believe belief is God, and it's advice to us is somehow the way to be saved, is everyone's time is getting wasted, just wasted. I see life after life after life after life, people simply wasting their time, wasting their days, wasting their hours, wasting their minutes, trying to do the impossible, trying to follow the instructions of belief, trying to please belief, trying to learn to love this hypothetical scenario of the obstruction of reality. It's not lovable. So if you want love, find what is lovable. And you're not going to find it within belief, not within impermanence. You will not. But you don't have to have a break in continuity. You can take this. You can have this overlay, which overlays it all. And then you will be saying, well, I love everything I'm seeing because it's all overlaid by what is lovable. You're not really loving the body, this body, that body. The body's overlaid. You're not loving this tree. The tree is overlaid. You're loving the overlay of all this impermanence because the overlay is permanent and it's equally the same everywhere. The cat just showed up. They always show up. They always want something. They don't show up unless they want something. You notice that with cats. We think that they like us, but they're very clever. Or they're super pragmatic. And they just say, I want something, and so I'm going to butter up this person, and I can get it that way. They figured out how to get stuff. So we're still broadcasting. Everything's fine. Everything is fine. Had a little break in continuity there. Not much. So we believe that these teachers, these great ambassadors of certitude, have learned somehow to love everything in the world. No, they have not. They've recognized that there's nothing in the world that can be loved. So they chose another idea, and this effect of this idea is to see everything as it is, and this. Accepting everything as it is this overlay of as it isness over everything that we, of this whole entire hypothetical scenario that we're projecting into what we call time or the future, it covers that all equally. And they're seeing that, they're experiencing that, which is entirely lovable. So of course they're in bliss, of course they're radiating love. And we keep scratching our heads and saying, what's the matter with us? What's the matter with us? How come we can't do that? And we think, wow, I need many lifetimes, and I'm going to go, into poverty-stricken areas, and I'm going to starve myself, and I'm going to get sick, and I'm going to hang out with all the sickness and problems, and I'm going to learn to love all this stuff, and I'm going to say, oh, it's just wonderful, and the trauma and suffering, I'm going to learn how to love it. I'm going to learn to love my death. Learn to love everything about my life. I just love it all. But it's not effortless love, is it? There's an effort to it. It's not the love of these great saviors, ambassadors of certitude. It's totally different. Totally different. And without those ambassadors here, it's easy for belief to deceive us. Easy. Because belief will say, well, no, you just need to learn to love the stuff like this one, or this one's like this one's doing it. You see how they're doing it? And yet you feel within them, it's not this total seamless, effortless radiance of love that is was not even needing to have any consideration whatsoever. You say, no, it's not that. It's somehow that they have sort of working this love angle thing in some way, but its strategy is involved in some way. That's how the feeling I get. When I look at a lot of the teachers in the world, I notice there is a sense of strategy. How do I know that? Because I could compare it with a perfect teacher. And if you have a perfect teacher here, you can compare and you can recognize, oh, no, there's a difference. There is a difference. So they have not chosen the overlay. They have not chosen the overlay. Or they're still, there's some deep consideration of how can they integrate that at some point in the future. That is still an issue, right? That has not been quite resolved in them. So there is some still, you know, they're still trying to work that out. Perfect teacher knows there is no future. There's no need to integrate it into any future at all. Reality is eternal. There's nothing outside of reality. In other words, some future outside of reality, beyond reality, anything like that, never will be. And they're perfectly certain of that. So their love is just radiates in all directions. It's not no strategies involved. No strategy. None. No, that is what we can do. That is what we have to do. But when we don't have teachers like that in the world that are that profound, belief says, you see, then it lowers the bar and says, this is your goal. And it requires some strategy to it. You need to, and then it says, then it starts slipping in. You need to learn to love. There, let's have a retreat. And we'll all learn to love one another there at the retreat. And we'll learn how to love the world. Learn how to love the world. We'll learn how to love the universe. We'll learn how to love everything around us. We'll be more loving people in the world. And we'll bring a golden age because we'll have all these loving people in the world. That's just belief. That is just following the guidance of belief. It's getting nowhere. It's getting nowhere except disillusionment. And you see these people have been on that path and they have these great smiles plastered on their face. And you can see the effort there, you know. I love everybody. I love everyone. I love everything. My life is so lovable. Like that. And I'm so sad to see that. Because they're just trying to please belief and say, hey, look, belief, I love everybody. I loved everyone my whole life. I love everyone. Everything is happening to me. There's nothing I don't love. I love my death that's coming. I love everything. And, you know, you can feel like this immense strategy and effort and like, please, belief, accept this because this is the best I can do. Come on, hurry up, accept it. I'm so tired to have that smile on my face. My God, I want to drop it, you know. I hate this place. My God, I hate this place. Are you kidding me? This place is terrible. I hate this hypothetical projection of time and space. I hate it. No, they're... Come on, belief, please accept this. Please tell me it's good enough. Please tell me. And if you just tell me that, I'll be happy forever. You see all these headshots of all these spiritualites in the world, and they're all like that, you know. They're beaming. They're so happy. I love it all. This is just incredible. I love it. I just love it. And, oh, my gosh. You see him. I mean, for 1 minute, we can all do it. For a snapshot, we can do it, right? We can go. Then, whew, you know, I didn't sleep last night. Gosh, I woke up 20 times last night. I feel horrible. I hate this. My whole body's aching. My gosh. So, now, that's not it. And the problem is if we don't have these super teachers in the world, these ambassadors of certitude, belief will say, that is it. You need to pass the exam that belief is giving you, that you've learned to love sufficiently, and that supposedly belief is going to reward you with eternal life if you just learn to love this hypothetical scenario of impermanence and destruction and death and suffering and threat. vulnerability, etc., etc., etc. If you just learn to love it, belief is going to say, okay, you did it. You did it good enough. Patch on the back. You're in. You're in. Well, where are you into? Where are you into? Is belief the one that returns you to reality? No, belief is a denial of reality. So where are you into? Well, the afterlife, maybe. Some nice place in the afterlife for a little while. Before belief taps you on the shoulder again and says, well, you know what? There's another great lesson to learn. That's what it does. It says, yeah, you made it, but I got an even greater opportunity for you. And now you can even learn to love more. And I'm sending you back down into the lower realms of existence so you can learn to love even more. Wow. And everyone says, wow, isn't that great? But I kind of like staying here. And belief says, well, you know what? I can't let you stay here. That wouldn't be good for your development. So I'm going to have to send you down there. And you say, well, I don't want to go. And belief says, you must go. Don't anger me. Don't anger me. I might take this away from you. And you go, oh, no, 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 no. Okay, I'll go. And then you've got another body, and there you are. And there you have the colic, the colds, the flus, the problem of sleeping, the bullies, the instability, the insecurity, not sure what you need to do, the hard work, the relationship problems, the sickness, and on and on, and the get in trouble with the law, you get in trouble in all sorts of ways, you have stress, the sicknesses, the infirmities, you get old, the age is creeping up on you, and you're in a retirement home, and you get all medded up, and then you die, and there you go again. See, and you say, yeah, God, it's hard to love this. Hard to love this. Yeah, it's really having problems. Got a lot of problems loving this. Oh, man, it's tough. This one's tough. This one's tough, you say. And for me, this one was really tough. And in fact, it was so tough, I said, wait a minute. This is like brutally tough. Well, there's something is screwy here. I don't trust the whole situation at all. And then I got a glimpse of reality. I said, whoa, through the flag. On belief, as I'm throwing the flag, time out. We're going to review this whole thing. And so I've been reviewing the whole thing, and belief says, come on, you got to get going. You got to learn how to love what you waste in your whole life. And I say, well, maybe I've been wasting my entire life because I haven't been working on learning to love all this stuff. But maybe I haven't been wasting my life because I'm seeing that it's impossible to learn to love. You can't learn to love. Either it's lovable or it isn't. And if it isn't, it's not real. It's just a fantasy, it's a hypothetical scenario. So maybe I haven't been wasting my life. So belief will scare you. It says if you're not trying to learn to love, you're wasting your life. And all this whole effort of suffering will be, you have to do it all over again. That's what belief tells you. And there are even some teachers in the history, teachers, they say the same doggone thing, and it's not true from my perspective. I'm telling you my perspective. My perspective is absolutely false. There are no lessons to learn here. None. All we need to learn is we're not here. We're not here. We're not in this future hypothetical. We're not in time. And that's not a lesson to be learned in time. Because we're not in time. How can we learn it in time? We're not even in time. We can't learn to love. And we don't get penalized for that. It's not, I haven't wasted my life. I have not. Because I said, no, I'm not doing anything with love. I'm not trying to learn to love. Forget that. And so if I don't like something, I don't try to change that. So what? It's irrelevant. However I react to some stuff, is, I like that. It's a nice song. It's not such a nice song. So what? It's not important. What is important is to realize I'm not even here. I'm not here in time and space. This is a projection, hypothetical scenario being projected as what anticipating what we expect will happen at some point, and we need to prepare for it, as somehow we're able to separate cause and effect. But we'll never separate cause and effect, so it will never happen. So we're just imagining this scenario as a way to work on a solution to a problem we believe is going to arise at some point, and it'll never arise. So we're not in this hypothetical scenario. We're imagining it, dreaming it. We dream we're in it. We're imagining we're in it. We have something to symbolize what we are. The body-mind symbolizes the self. And then all the sojourns and problems of this body-mind and how it tries to fix this problem, etc., is how we are working on trying to and fix the problems that we anticipate once these problems supposedly arise. But they never will arise. So we're not in this dream at all. That's what we need to realize. That's the realization. Not learning to love. Love will come automatically when we perceive the overlay. We'll say, oh my gosh, I love this completely. I just totally love this. It's just no effort to it. It's effortless. How could it's impossible not to love it? Impossible not to love it. And you realize, I don't have to integrate this with time. There's no need to integrate it with time. There is no time. I'm not in time. This is not in time. We'll never be in time. There's no problems ever going to arise from reality that I need to anticipate and figure out a way to fix it ahead of time. There will never be any problem in reality. So this is the kind of teaching I wish I would have heard, you know, growing up in my life. So I'm just giving the teaching. This is what I would want to hear. This is what I want to hear. My gosh, I searched and searched and searched. I couldn't find it anywhere. It's completely nuts. There's some that allude to this in certain ways, have their own way of saying it. But I prefer, you know, just really adamant, passionate, direct speech about it. Because, well, why not? Why not? Again, belief frightens us, saying we're wasting our life. We're not wasting our lives listening to this and considering this. Belief is lying. It's bluffing. Because you can't learn to love this hypothetical scenario. You cannot learn to love what is unreal, because there's nothing there. How can you love nothing? You cannot. It's crazy to say that we can. That is nonsense. Give a little break here. I'm da 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 da. I'm not going like that. But this is what I want to hear. This is what I've always heard. How come we didn't have this, you know, in our lives before? Wow. Because belief bluffs us. It says we're wasting our time, wasting our life. Why waste our life? Now, let's instead try to learn to love everything. And you don't get very often, apparently, in this world, someone who says, you know what? I'm throwing the red flag. I'm putting this whole thing under review. I think this is completely bogus. This whole situation is likely to be totally bogus, and I'm going to risk it. I'm going to risk wasting my life in case it turns out to be bogus. And that's what I did. That's what I did. I was super blessed by great teachers and teaching and determination and circumstances that blocked me in certain ways. And I just said, you know what? My life is so terrible. I don't really care if I'm wasting it or not. It's irredeemable. My suffering is irredeemable. It's just horrible. I might as well just see if it's really legitimate or not. And somehow, I was able to continue pursuing that. Somehow the grace of God orchestrated that. So I'm able to talk this way, but I wish that there were, you know, those in my life earlier that spoke this way and just laid it on the line. And fortunately, you know, A Course in Miracles does speak in this sort of way, in this sort of way. And you can extract the adamancy from it, but there are also others who don't extract it. And what they get from it is that it's telling them they need to learn to love everything. That's how they see it. I don't see that at all. I really don't. And if there is someone that there, I dismiss it. It cannot be possible. It cannot be true. How can you learn to love nothing? How can you learn to love a lie? It's not possible. There's nothing. It's a meaningless statement. Because love has to have meaning. You have to love something that has meaning. If something has no meaning, saying you love it is ridiculous. It is ridiculous. It means it gives no meaning to love, which is ridiculous. It's not true. It's a lie. So you have to look at it that way. It's not a waste of your life at all. But that is the fear in which that bends people, you know. It slows them down. They're scared. They say, gosh, this world's tough enough. I don't want to hear at the end of this my life that I wasted my life. That'll crush me. Just crush me. You know, if I hear that at the end of my life, I'll say, well, you're mistaken. I didn't waste my life. And who is it that's telling me that? And I won't agree at all. So I'm really not afraid of that. You know, if there's some God saying, you didn't learn to love, you know, and you're going to have to go back. Boy, you really wasted your time. I said, well, you know, you're just a god of belief. I'm not bowing to you at all. I didn't waste my time one bit. And you know, dismiss it. And say, well, there's no place in the afterlife for you. And I say, well, I'm not looking for any place in the afterlife. So take a hike. And I'll go wherever I want to go. I'm free. So it's the god of belief that's telling us these things and intimidating us. And of course, since we want to be intimidated, we imagine this all-powerful deity, you know, telling us what to do in the dream, in the projection, a future projection of time and space. There is no real god in the projection of time and space, future. God is right now, not in time. And I don't mean the nowness of time. You see, that when people say you need to step into the right now, that's the nowness of time. No, that's not now. That's not what we're talking about. Stepping into the overlay, that's now, where that which overlays all time and space and all circumstances and situations in time and space, that is lovable, and that is now, because it has meaning, because it's not something that is yet to be determined or something that's going to change. How can you love something if it's going to change? You don't know what it's going to change into. Can't really love that. It's strategy. You're saying, how much love do I give it now, and how do I apportion this, and when do I need to take it away? And it's strategy. Ananda Mayamma was not strategizing. I noticed that in her right away. I said, whoa, this is completely different fish. What is this fish? You know, it's like you're a fisherman and you've been fishing a long time. You pulled up all these exotic fish. I was born focused on saints and sages and avatars and gurus and saviors. As a child, that's all I thought about. And so I was aware of all these different teachers in history. And I studied every day. I still do, you know, every day, this teacher and that teacher and that teacher and that teacher. And then I saw a video of Ananda Mayamma, and I just stopped me in my tracks. Immediately stopped me in my tracks completely. And I said, what is this? Never seen anything like this. What in the world is this? It's like some fish I never imagined possible. What is this? And I just is like, oh, there's no strategy there. Nothing. Nada. No strategy whatsoever. Is this possible? Am I seeing correctly? I said, yeah, I'm seeing correctly. I trust it. It's obvious to me. And I was like dumbfounded. I was dumbfounded and just nonplussed. I said, what in the world? There's no zero strategy there. No strategizing. She's not saying, okay, you know, I need to love here, a little more here, a little more there in the future. I need to back off here, put more here. No strategy. Zero. Love radiating like that at all times without any strategy involved in that whatsoever. Not the slightest concern about that. Like somehow she's might be making any mistakes about that. That somehow the future, something might change and there might need to be some change in what she's doing. None. No thought about it. None. She was giving it no thought whatsoever. The radiance of love. So I saw that and I said, holy cow. That was like a complete mind, you know, just blew my mind. I just, holy cow, just stopped me in my tracks. Absolutely stopped me in my tracks. I said, what is going on here? What is going on here? Because this is something I haven't seen before. What is going on here? No strategy. Zero. So that's not, I said, let me look some more. And I can keep looking. Still no strategy. No strategy. I can find no evidence whatsoever that she ever had any type of strategy. Of course, she would go different places depending on who was most receptive. But as far as the radiance of the love, there was no strategy, no thought to it at all. I said, oh, man, wow. That puts a whole different frame on the picture here. Whole different frame. And that puts belief in a very bad position. Puts belief in a corner, really corners belief. And then I realized I had belief cornered. And that's when I said, hey, belief, you know, your days are numbered. Your days are numbered because you're a liar. You know, you've been lying about this need for strategy. Here's someone here that is not using any strategy whatsoever and yet functioning perfectly well and being absolutely fabulously helpful. And they're not using strategy for love, not at all. So what is this whole learn to love thing in time, strategizing this stuff? It's nonsense. It's a lie. It's a deception. So I had belief cornered. And so then I've been, you know, got belief in a corner and belief is trying to get out. And no, I'm keeping you in that corner until I dismiss it. I'm going to, once I get, see, okay, you're dismissed. you're not going to bother me anymore. Forget about it. So it's super helpful if you come across one who has no zero strategy. Super helpful. It'll stop you in your tracks. And you just say, well, what is this? I thought I knew what saints and sages and teachers were. I thought I knew. But it turns out I really didn't know. I didn't really know. I might have had some inkling, but no, it's different. It's really zero thought to it. No thought to it whatsoever. Not even like in a billion years, a trillion years, maybe there needs might be a tiny little bit of thought to it. Not even that. Not even that. And you're just laughing. You're laughing. Just this is great. It just loves it. You know, just loved being here. Just loved it. Loved what she was experiencing, the overlay. Perfect awareness of reality and isness. Just loved it. Everlessly loved it. And knowing that time will never have any effect on it whatsoever. Perfectly aware of that. And no strategy then is needed. No strategy. That motivates us. That puts belief in a corner. And this big lie that we need to learn to love. We say, oh, wait a minute. I see this. Something is completely bogus about this. Let me track this down. Because that is a big, huge lie. It is a lie that has been driving spirituality here for so long. So long. It has to be exposed and outed and vetted and seen. It's not true. You don't fix an unreal problem by making it real and then fixing it. You fix it by realizing it is unreal. We are not saved by believing that we're in this dream, a future, and figuring out how to learn to love all this supposed future. So that when this supposed separation of cause and effect happens, we'll still be in love. We'll say, well, we already learned how to love this whole thing. We modeled this hypothetical scenario. We learned how to love it. And so there's no problem with cause and effect separating. Everything will be fine. We'll still be in this glorious kingdom and loving everything. That's what we're trying to do. That is what we're trying to do. And it's completely insane, completely impossible. And it's not the way to salvation. And hopefully, well, I know that just being able to say this is a great thing. Be able to focus in on this, which is like a sacred area. Nobody's focusing on this. Very few. To be able to focus on that is an enormous breakthrough. That it can be done here. It's very easy for me. Very easy. I'll always be able to do this at this now. Because I see, words are easy to come. It's easy for these words to come. It's easy to talk about this. It's no big deal. What's the big deal? It's not a big deal. It's not a big deal. It's just we have to, you know, we're used to using words in a different way. And we think, wow, how can I use the words in this way? It's no big deal at all. Words are nothing in of themselves. We just ascribe meaning to them. We have a consensual agreement that this word water means this H2O or whatever. It's just consensual. There's no real actual meaning to words whatsoever. So we can use words however we want to. And you can just say, hey, I can use words this way. I can look at it this way. I can tune into it. I just tune into it. I can tune the radio to this station. It's no problem. Don't you, of course, then belief says you're wasting your life. And there you're right back in the nitty-gritty of it. Right back in the nitty-gritty of it. But you see it. When you see you're having problems, say, whoa, belief's telling me I'm wasting my life. And then that is the problem. Am I? You say, am I really? And then you say, well, I'm not so sure. I mean, here's someone who says I'm not wasting my life. And yeah, so then you can say, I want to keep working on this because I intuitively feel it's accurate, it's true, and it's not a waste of my time. It's not a waste of my life. Now, of course, belief, when you die, belief's going to try and scare you and say, you wasted your life, you didn't listen to me. Next time, you're going to really have to do what I want you to do. Of course, belief will try to do that. But once you've experiencing the overlay, there is no more belief arising for you. So you can't, there's nothing there to say that to you. And even if someone else would say it to you, it's just gibberish. It doesn't mean anything. It has no meaning to it. It's not bothersome. And I know Ma said she was never bothered by the world, by all the craziness that people threw at her. She said, no, never. I was never inconvenienced in the slightest bit. And because there was never any temptation to give thought to her love, to strategize what she, the lovability of what she was seeing was instant, perfect, flawless. So there's never any need to say, well, maybe I better strategize because someone's throwing this craziness at me, this gibberish, this nonsense. No, she just laughed. You know, it's just as happy as can be. Have complete bliss all the time, all the time. Yogananda said, I've never met anyone that is in perfect bliss constantly, no matter what happens. He said, no matter what happens, where she is, talking, writing, sleeping, going, walking, visiting, it's all the same to her. She's still in the exact same highest bliss at all times. He says, that is just incredible. It's amazing. He said, I've heard of this, and it's possible, and I might have seen some that might be like this, but this is extraordinary, absolutely extraordinary, which is true, absolutely extraordinary. But it is exactly what we need to do, exactly. That's what we all have to do. And nothing, anything less than that is strategizing, which is trying to please belief, which is futile, which will result in another life, another birth. Maybe after a long afterlife, as belief is being careful with you, because it knows you're getting close to standing up to it. So it says, I'll give you an extra long afterlife in the astral, etheric astral, mental, causal worlds, and you'll be thousands of years just, you know, having wonderful experiences there. And then eventually you'll have to come back. So it's not freedom. It's not freedom at all. You're not free of belief at all. Who wants a long afterlife? I don't want any afterlife. I don't need an afterlife. I need reality. Reality is not the afterlife. That's not reality. That's still belief. I want the overlay. I want the overlay not only of the entire, the hypothetical scenario that we're projecting into an imaginary future is both the time here with the body, mind, and after we die, the body, mind dies, the whole afterlife. It's all of that. It's all of that. That's all a dream. It's all a projection. It's all imagination. All of it. So the overlay overlays all of that. It overlays this world. It overlays the whole afterlife, all the realms of the afterlife, everything. It overlays it all. The presence of God, in other words, is everywhere, felt everywhere. And on my mom said, felt the presence of God seamlessly everywhere, equally everywhere. And she said in the afterlife too, she was aware of the whole afterlife realms, all of them. She said, I feel exactly the same about them as I do about this world. I don't see any difference. I don't feel any different toward any of it. And there's nothing that's ever going to happen that's going to make me feel any different about it, because she's experiencing the overlay, the presence of God. Presence of God in all of that. The overlay, that which accepts what is as it is, does not trying to change it, which what is reality. So it is like a reflection of reality, as it were. And she said, beyond this bliss that she's experiencing is the great bliss. There's even a greater bliss beyond all that, which is actually functioning in reality. And she was aware of that too. The great bliss. But playing the role of perfect bliss in this world, playing that role, but also simultaneously aware of the great bliss of reality. But we, all we have to do is the bliss, the overlay, the bliss of that overlay. Strategy free, effort free. Not worried about how does it need to adapt at some point in time. It's not in time, it's overlaying time. That which overlays is not within. Jesus said, in the world but not of it. The overlay is not of the world, it overlays it. It overlays all of it, but it's not an effect of the world. It's an effect of a different causal agent. Causal agent, I'm not trying to be prime creator. That's what it is. It's an effect of that different causal agent. So we're talking here about we can't learn to love in this hypothetical scenario. We're not in the scenario, okay? It's all a projection of what a problem we expect will happen when we somehow figure out how to separate cause and effect, which we never will ever do. But we're wanting to. So we believe whatever we want, it will happen. So we say, oh boy, there could be a problem there. So let us model this problem ahead of time, learn to love what's going to happen once we separate cause and effect, and then we'll have our own kingdom, and we'll love it. And so we're trying to learn how to love this impermanence, this horrible, terrible, ghastly, homicidal nightmare of existence, of just horror. It's fear, terror. It's awful, absolutely awful. We're trying to learn to love it. So of course we're trying to learn to love it. Everyone's going to say how nice it is if we go around. And isn't this wonderful? When I look at the world, I don't see that at all. I see. I look at people and say, my God, they're suffering so terribly. I can see the angst within them, and I see that when you know no one's looking, I see them just like they're like collapsing. The fatigue, the stress, the strain, the fear, the deep-seated anguish and cry within them. That's what I see. And the dread as their death is stalking them, the dread that you know death is catching up to them. And his age catch up to them, and the shaking with terror, you know, just shaking, it seems shaking. And the young people, I see the foolhardiness and the bravado, you know, of the young, which is a response to the fear that they feel, is a bravado. So I see, that's how I see the world. I see it in an entirely negative way, of something that is just atrocious, absolutely atrocious. But it doesn't wipe me out or depress me because I know the remedy for it. So if you know a remedy, you're not going to be wiped out by seeing the world as it is. You will not. And I don't make a point to focus on that, but I certainly don't try to learn to love the world either. Of course, if you make a focus of just trying to see, you know, how everyone's suffering and all the plants are dying and breaking and everything's crumbling and disintegrating, and which it is, everything is impermanence. You see the impermanence of everything. If you're just focusing on that, you know, of course that's going to be like a downer for you. But you could simply continue, you know, you notice it. But not obsess about it. But you don't try to learn to love it. I'm not spending my time trying to learn to love anything here. Because I know it's futile. So I spend my time actually calling the bluff of belief. All this many tricks and beliefs and saying I'm wasting my time, wasting my life, and saying no I'm not, and sticking with it, and seeing all the deals that belief is offering me are no deals at all, you know, seeing that is what I see is right use of time. You don't see many who have their profile pics. I mean, I had to, maybe I'll put up a different profile pic. I had to at least, you know, try to, yeah, I'm, you know, I want to show I'm not miserable, even though I am, but there's optimistic that I'm going to realize the situation. So I'm optimistic, very optimistic about it. So my smile is from that optimism of knowing that I'm going to succeed in this endeavor. And it's from that. But very, very rarely do you see someone who gives a headshot, you know, their profile, their picture, who's not trying to project some kind of happiness or I'm loving something or yeah, I'm fine, everything's great here. And very rarely, you know, you see someone who's just like that, very rarely, like, I'm not happy at all. I'm really unhappy. I hate this place. I'm really thinking about how do I get out, how do I escape this nightmare? Like that. Rarely do you see that, especially among the spiritualites. You never see it. You never see that. Come on, be honest. And say, what's going on here? Like that profile. I'm trying to figure out what's going on here. I really am. Honest profile. And the reason I used to, my profiles were like that. And I decided to put up one that I had some kind of smile to convey that I am going to get free of this delusion. And I'm anticipating that. That is, you know, anticipating that. But certainly not because I'm learning to love anything here, which is what most of the spiritualites are doing, saying, I'm really advanced learning to love everything here. And gosh, I'm anticipating just being part of this kingdom of love here because it's going to happen. It's going to happen. And I'm almost there and I just can't wait to really love it, because it's going to be really lovable. Yeah, how wonderful. That's the spiritualites. And no, there's no such thing as any unreal kingdom being lovable. There's no kingdom here at all. It's just a hypothetical scenario, an attempt to accomplish the impossible, a modeling of how to fix a problem that will never be. Complete waste of time. We can't love that, but we can love the overlay of it, which we can do that. Once the overlay arrives, we will love that for sure. So I'm optimistic, but I don't go around beaming at everyone. You know, come on, for what? Who's kidding who? Who's kidding who? Saying I'm happy, you must be happy too. Nobody's happy here. Nobody's happy here. All right. I've learned to love a lot of stuff. You must have learned to love a lot too, huh? No, nobody's learned to love anything here. There are some who are very good at projecting that they've almost learned to love everything here, almost, and that they're going to learn. They're going to learn how to love everything here. They're sure of it. They're really sure, and they project that surety, but it's strategic. You can still feel the strategy there. And if you compare that to like an Anamayma, you say it's night and day. It's not the same quality at all. Not at all. Because her surety is completely, completely effortless. And doesn't have a single thought for it at all. No concern or thought for it whatsoever, knowing it can never be other than that. Whereas this other certitude is saying, I'm certain I'm going to be certain. That's different. I'm certain I'm going to be able to learn how to love everything because I know I'm going to be able to do that. I'm certain of it. But it hasn't happened yet. And so they're thinking, what is it that is holding me back? Or what is it that's going to be a problem that I need to overcome? I still need to overcome something. So I have to have that certitude to overcome something, right? So they don't rest in it. They don't rest in it. They don't abide in it. They don't abide in it. They project it. They don't abide in it. It's a difference. They project love. They don't abide in it. Like Ramana Maharshi was abiding in this love. There's another great teacher, abiding in that love. He wasn't projecting it at all. No projection. No thought, no projection. Effortless abidance in it. Because what he was experiencing was lovable. Without except with perfectly so, flawlessly so, seamlessly so, seamlessly, no fragmentation to it, seamlessly so. No strategy. So it's different. It's not projecting love. But people, so many here are doing is trying to learn how to love, to project, trying to learn how to project love. Love cannot be projected. Because what is lovable is here right now perfectly, in its entirety, in its eternity, the eternal now. And only that is lovable. It doesn't have any future. It doesn't have any future where it's not what it eternally is. So it is lovable. But the future is not lovable because there's nothing in the future. How can we say we love nothing? There's nothing real is in the future. It doesn't have any future. What is real never has a future to it. Never. Because it eternally is what it is. Endlessly is what it is. So there's no point, some future where it'll not be what it is. None. So there you go. So anything we imagine in the future is really nothing. And nothing is not lovable. There's nothing there to love, be lovable. It's absurdity to say that nothing is lovable. I'm loving nothing. It's very lovable. That is projecting love. And there's some that are very good at projecting love like that, projecting it and wanting you to say, hey, I can teach you how to project love. Well, sure, they can teach you how to project love. It's a waste of your time, though. And they can throw in a bunch of spiritual teachings that are true, but that's not what they're teaching. To make it seem like that's what they're teaching. They're teaching projecting love, and they can throw in a whole bunch of non-dual stuff, you know, that makes it seem like they're right teaching the same thing as someone else, a teacher who's abiding in love. And you think, oh, they're teaching the same thing, they're saying the same words, but what they're showing you is projecting love. See, it's a mixed message, and then that delays you. It sidetracks you. Sidetracks you severely. And the sugarcoating of their teaching, what they're teaching you is how to project love, and they sugarcoat it to make it seem like they're really some perfect non-dual teacher who's teaching you how to abide in love. But they've confusing projecting love with abidance in love. And they still are setting the whole thing within time, believing that at some point, could be a trillion years from now, that there'll be a problem will arise, and you have to learn how to project love at that point. You see, so it's still their aim, and that's not salvation. It is not, and it's a waste of time. It is a waste of time. As I was super fortunate to get these genuine, real teachers who are abiding in love. And they said, don't waste time with these others. Forget about it. Don't worry about it. Just keep on clarifying. Keep on clarifying. And so I said, okay, you know, I keep looking for teachers. I can't ever find any. I cannot ever meet up with any. It's unbelievable. I always find out that they were just here in the Bay Area last week. I say, oh, I missed it again. I said, how come I didn't know? I said, God, how come you didn't tell me this teacher was coming here on their world tour? I could have gone and seen him. You know, I could have gone there. Doggone it. Always like that. It's unbelievable. They always just left town when I find out about him. And I say, well, what's going on? That's terrible. Well, maybe not so terrible. Maybe not so terrible. Because maybe they are teaching projecting love. Maybe they're teaching them how to project love, and they're not actually abiding in it. Or not effortlessly abiding in it. There's still some issues there. There's still some projection there. It's possible, very possible. And for some reason, the grace of God says, look, your path will go quicker if you don't go see them. It'll go quicker, actually. I said, oh, wow, really? Is that possible? Really? Yeah, it probably is possible, because when you go to see someone who's projecting love and on the surface they're teaching this, you know, real cool non-dual teaching, you know, like the eternal now and all this stuff, but they're actually teaching you a projection of love, you're going to get confused and you're going to say, you know, how do I please this teacher? You know, there's something here I'm not getting. Maybe there's something wrong with me. And you get pulled into it and you start wasting time right and left. And it becomes a very sticky situation actually for you. And you feel, eventually you start feeling a lot of guilt. There's something wrong with you. And it starts becoming fearful. And if you can't figure out the strategy or what's going on, and it's not good. It's not good. So I've avoided all that. And then now I'm able to see the problem, and not judging any of these people in the world, because it's a difficult, tricky thing. It's a tricky thing, because belief will just tell you, well, yeah, you can be free for a trillion years. You can be abiding love for a trillion years, but in your trillion and one, that's when the separation is going to take place, and you wouldn't have learned how to love the separation at that point. So, you know, and if you buy that at all, boom, you're in big trouble. You are strategizing, you're not abiding, and you're teaching projection of love. So either the freedom is perfect, or it's projection of love. You're stuck still, but you're projecting certitude and love for at least a trillion years, which is not abidance. It's not. Quality is not totally different. Totally different. Even if you say, oh, my beloved, we will be together almost forever in a day, but after that, we need to learn how to love one another. So let's keep working on that, beloved. You know, no, that's projecting love. That is delusion. That is trying to appease belief. That is still falling for belief. And it's simple to see this. It's not tough to talk about. It's not tough to see it. But belief will certainly knock on your door and say, hey, stop wasting your time. They'll certainly do that. And will say, hey, I'm the big kahuna. You know, what I say is gospel. And you'll say, oh, I'm not sure. It's just, well, I'll tell you what, you know. I'll tell you what, I'll post. You don't have to work on it for a long time. I'll give you vacation time. I'll give you vacation. I'll tell you what, rest of your life vacation, afterlife long vacation. How about that? How long? Says, well, long, long time. Don't worry about it. Really long time. You just see if you like it. Just give it a trial run, test run. It'll make those deals with you. And you have to say, no, no deal, no vacation. I don't want a vacation. I've got you cornered. I've got you cornered. I've got you pinned. And you're no longer this big monster. You're turning into this little pea, this little speck of dust. You're turning into nothing in front of my eyes. Why should I make a deal with that which is shrinking into nothing? You're in no position to be, you know, telling me I need to make a deal. So, seeing that, I say, I don't want any vacation. I don't need a vacation. I'll keep working. I'll keep working here. I don't take vacations on the path. Belief is always telling me, hey, I got a great vacation for you. And there's the cat. Great vacation for you. No. What was that? Computer making a funny noise. Yeah, still taping. Say, no deal, no vacation. I don't want a vacation because you're shrinking before my every day. You're shrinking more and more and more and more and more. And your threats that I'm wasting my time becoming less and less and less and less scary. And intuitively I say, you know, that's not true. It's not true. It's not true. Less believable, less believability to them. Less believability to those. So don't take a vacation from the path of this, of seeing the belief shrink before you. You know, this huge monster that used to terrorize you is now shivering in fear in the corner, you know, and saying, oh my, you know, I'm gonna get you for this. I'm gonna get you for this. At some point in the future, I'm gonna get you for this. And again, reality has no future. So sure, you say, you're gonna get me for this in the future, huh? Okay, whatever you want to say, but I'm choosing the eternal now. There is no future to reality. Reality is what it is forever. So you can face down belief like this. I'm just showing you it's possible, and not difficult. And I'm not giving belief an opportunity to respond, you know, and reassert itself. No, you get belief down. You keep diminishing it and keep seeing, pointing out truth. I'm not in this dream. It's a projection. I'm not in the future. Reality doesn't have any future. Never in the future. And this is all just a hypothetical scenario. I can choose to overlay this whole thing. I don't need to deal with belief at all. Belief's not a problem. Won't be a problem at all. Keep saying that. Don't let belief reassert itself. And of course, once I stop this taping, belief will say, okay, good job. Now let's go listen to some music. You deserve it. You deserve a treat for that great effort you did. And it'll pick some super catchy song that'll stick in my head for weeks, you know. And I, get it out of there. I can't get it out of there. It's terrible when a song sticks in your head. And all day long, you're singing these lyrics, blah, 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 over and over. And that's how belief says, oh, that's a reward for doing such a great satsang, great taping. Here's a song for you. Toss the dog a treat. You know, here you go, dog. Have a treat. And I say, no, I don't need a treat. I don't really need a treat. Forget it. What do I need? Why do I need a treat? I'm on the verge of choosing a new idea and experiencing the overlay and being experiencing everless love, seamless everless love. Why should I settle for some kind of song and a dance? Why? Yeah, but usually I do anyway, just because I'm kind of bored and say, well, I'm bored. But you gotta be careful about that. I'm pretty careful about it. I'm kind of like, whoa, keep getting bit. It's a pretty nasty bite when the song becomes super repetitive. Wow, that's horrible, horrible. I say, okay, that's the thousandth time that I've been singing this song, and it just won't stop. Because belief is desperate. It says, hey, listen to this song. You know, I'm giving you treats. I'm giving you treats. I'm giving you treats. I'm nice guy. I'm nice. Belief is nice. Come on, come on. Don't keep hammering away. Don't keep pushing me like this. Here's some treats for you. I say, no, those treats are nothing. They're nothing. That's not the overlay. Only the overlays time and space and project this projection, this hypothetical scenario. Only the overlays it. These treats don't overlay it. These treats are still in this hypothetical future, this futureness, which isn't this futureness. Well, it actually, it doesn't, we don't need to get into word games. It's not necessary. We'll just choose a different idea and choose to experience the overlay. And don't waste our time with trying to learn how to love. And those who are projecting love or certitude that they will succeed in learning how to love, projecting the certitude that they will eventually succeed to learn how to love, and therefore it's a fait accompli. So we might, you know, don't fall for that. Don't waste your time on that. Don't waste your time on that. And hopefully we will come across a perfect teacher at some point in this world who has zero strategy that will then really give us another big boost. I don't know of any that I would say are just flawless, you know, complete no strategy whatsoever, ever, and no thought ever to any need for any thought whatsoever. None, 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 zero. I'm not aware of any that are that way. That way, I know some teachers who show a lot of promise, but I'm not aware of anyone in the world that is that actually that way. There may be some. There may be some. I don't know. Maybe I'll come across one, or maybe my evaluation of some have been mistaken. That is always possible too. I don't have a perfect perspective in that way at this point, so I'll keep on, you know, I'll keep on wanting that for sure, but not holding my breath for it. Not holding my breath because it's not absolutely essential. It would be a big boost, but it's not, you know, totally essential, I would say. There are some that use previous ambassadors of servitude that have come here in the world in the past. They use those examples. And what does that smell? I don't know, something weird. Interesting how this smell is suddenly wafted through the air outside. Very different, very unique. Well, maybe that's a good, some kind of sign or something. That something will come along that has a rare fragrance to it. Rare, rare fragrance to it. The fragrance of flawlessness, the fragrance of no strategy, the fragrance of effortless no strategy, the fragrance of not even giving any thought whether it's effortless or not. That's right. No thought even arises whether to value whether it's effortless or not. That fragrance. And the cat is back. Okay, well, let's keep this one under 3 hours, shall we? Because it's getting cold. It's getting cold here. It's been a great one. It's really been a great one. Just, you know, pushing forward, even, you know, much, much more forging forward as we move toward the apocalypse. We're in the apocalypse and we're moving towards that apocalyptic, maybe December 21st is the apocalyptic moment when the unveiling will truly become noticeable. Truly be very noticeable. And maybe at that point, some perfect, flawless example will become noticeable to us. That's very possible. In fact, that may be what's going to happen. Because again, the unveiling will be, all everyone's gifts will be unveiled at the apocalypse. There'll be a progressive unveiling. And we'll be aware of what the gifts that we have. And one of the gifts that we deserve is the presence of flawless, strategy-free, certitude here. That is a gift that we deserve. And perhaps at the moment of the unveiling really becomes intense, we will then at that become aware of one or more in this world that are that way. That is very possible, actually. It just occurred to me. December 21st could be the date that that will happen. And I'm aiming for that now. That is a great, great goal to have. That there will be an unveiling at that point, and we'll become aware somewhere around that time frame that we will be aware of an ambassador of certitude here. And I'm not scared of them at all. I don't feel fearful. I wouldn't say at all. I would say by and large the lack of fear greatly outweighs the fear. So I'd be happy to come across Ambassador of Certitude anytime, but maybe the 21st, or the Mayans talked about that time as an unveiling, meaning the end of time, where there's this unveiling for those who want to reinvest in time, or those who want to free themselves from this projection of time. Perhaps that is the moment where the apocalypse becomes apparent, the unveiling becomes apparent. I wouldn't doubt it in the slightest bit, the way things are going and the way my own progress is going. I wouldn't doubt it at all. So that's something to look forward to greatly, and it's a reason why to give it right now, give it everything you've got to continue to stand up to the bully of belief and get this intuitive feeling that, you know what, a strategy-free love is, I'd be very happy to come across that, very happy. Maybe I'll make some video about some. I'm not making any promises about videos. It's very tough to make videos. It is not easy, and it just really ruins my eyes. My eyes become very, very bad and weakens them severely. So if I do, I do. If I don't, I don't. No promises on that. We'll see. All right, that's it for this one. Very, very great video here. I really enjoyed making this one.